lazy river by the old mill run. The lazy, lazy river in the noonday sun lingered in the shade of a
garden. When I was born, they didn't show me to my mother for 2 days. And since I was the first child, she didn't realize that was such a problem. They thought I was going to die because at the base of my skull on the back, there was a large blood clot. And if it moved at all, I'd be gone. But they didn't think I would ever develop normally. And when the doctor's partner saw me a year later when I came in for shots, he said, "Oh, is that the Hartzell baby? Let me see her. You know, we never thought she'd walk or talk." I thought I would be a vegetable.
Up a lazy river by the old mill run. The lazy, lazy river in the noonday sun. Linger in the shade of a kind old tree.
Throw away your troubles, dream a dream with me. Oh,
up a lazy river where the robbers...
This is the night of Sadie Hawkins. Mary Clark and I are having a party. This is your fireside reporting. I'll have the woman on the right first. What is your name, ma'am?
It's Mary Clark. I believe Sadie Hawkins Day should be observed as a national holiday, especially in Minnesota.
Up a lazy river with me. Oh, up a lazy river by the old mill.
We also went to Florida in the wintertime. Spend, you know, a month maybe down in Florida, in Miami, which at that time was, I can't even explain what it's like compared to now. The streets were small and lined with tourist shops, and everything was orange. Everything you bought was orange, made of oranges or orange flavored, and everything was on a small scale and pseudo Spanish in style. And later, when my grandparents drove us down, and when we weren't in the trailer, my grandparents would take us down. We'd go as far as Bluefield. And they had huge Chryslers they bought from my father.
With me, up a lazy river, with me.
My parents were a great deal of influence on me, but so was my Aunt Vera.
Mary Clark, liked to catch bees, and we couldn't explain to her that they would sting and hurt people. She brought a glass jar of bees in onto the screened-in back porch where Emily Ann was a little baby just sitting up, and let them loose. Some of them stung Emily Ann, and still Mary Clark couldn't understand. Then Mary Clark went out in the yard and stepped on one and got stung herself. She said, "I didn't know they'd hurt."
And she made sure that we traveled a lot and saw a lot of different things from what most kids saw growing up back in the 30s when people didn't travel a lot. We traveled. So I always had this sense of adventure. And my mother was interested, too, in people, international things. And she always took advantage of the presence of different kinds of people in the community to make sure that we had a chance to enjoy getting to know them. So from the time I was small, adventure and an international perspective permeated my life. And I wanted to travel, so my grandparents gave me a trip to Mexico, a bike trip, chaperoned by the head of American Youth Hostels, Monroe Smith, I think his name was. So I basically spent a couple of months in Mexico bicycling with some other teenagers. It was great. Right after I got back from Mexico, I had a health crisis and almost died. So I was a month late arriving at college. I had won a 4-year fellowship to Lawrence College in Appleton, Wisconsin. It was a glorious 4 years. It was exhilarating. I loved to learn, and there were so many enormous ideas and intellectual challenges that I was fortunate enough to be exposed to. So one day, when I was a junior in college, I got this pamphlet in the mail, and it advertised the first work camps that the Methodist Church was going to do overseas. And I got accepted. The country was ruled by Batista, who was a terrible dictator. And anyway, I just loved it. I loved every suffering minute of it. It was beastly hot and humid, And we had to walk, of course, and I was alone. I mean, I just followed the road and went to every house along it. Somebody else was, another girl was in a different area. There were three girls and five boys in the group. The boys built a community house along with the men, but I taught. And what I found was these women were so grateful to have anyone to come see them. They were stuck with a baby a year in huts that had no floors, just dirt floors, no doors. They were made of cane stalks. That's all it was, tied together, thatched, cane thatched roofs. I just loved it. I felt so fulfilled. I felt like this is what I want to do the rest of my life. I love serving people, and I love doing something that makes them happy and is valuable to them. And I was beginning to feel like I understood. I felt I had a closeness to God that I'd never had in my whole life and didn't even really particularly believe in, but it was happening to me. So I decided I wanted to be a missionary. So I was invited to speak at the fall conference of the Methodist Student Movement, which I had never participated in because I had dropped out of the church. So I was invited to be their keynote speaker on Friday night. The conference started with supper Friday night and ended the next Saturday afternoon. We all went back to our schools. Okay, so I arrived there from Lawrence, and I'm sitting there. I registered. I'm sitting there waiting for other people to register in the evening, dinner to start. And I see this group come in. They were from Madison, for the UW-Madison. And in the group, there was this drop-dead handsome man. I mean, one look at him, and I said, oh, that's the one I want. I met him on the 30th, Friday the 30th of October, 1948. The next day was Halloween. And I don't know who wrote first, but we wrote letters to each other by Thanksgiving. And at Thanksgiving, he invited me to come down to Madison for the Christmas dance that the International Club was giving. He was very much into international things on campus. It must have been a nice night because I remember walking through some kind of garden-y place and talking about, and he was saying things like, in the rest of my life, we're going to spend the rest of our life together, blah, 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 blah. But he never said, will you marry me? We just got swept away. I got swept away. And I swept him away too, because same thing. Finally, after this is going on and on and on, and we're kissing and talking about our future together and all that, I finally said, you mean get married? Because he hadn't mentioned that. And there was a pause, I suppose, for a second or two, and he said, yes. The night I met him, I fell in love with him. First time I met him. And I just knew immediately, not only was he immensely handsome, but we also thought alike on everything. It was just amazing. We both were internationally minded. We both wanted to serve. It was just like, I don't know. When we met, I'd experienced a call. I experienced some work camp in Cuba, which led me to understand that what I wanted to do with my life was service to others. So when he met me and I wanted to go overseas too, I said, well, why don't we be missionaries? Oh, he said, well, So it was, that's what we did.
I love you for sentimental reasons. I hope you do believe me. I'll give you my heart. I love you.
Yeah, we started seminary together on January something, the first week in January. And I had morning sickness, ugh. And I'd sit in there in the classroom. Unfortunately, the door was at the back and I was sort of toward the front to the right. And in order to get out, I had to trip over two guys, Gary and another guy, go the whole length of the room to throw up.
I think of you every morning. dream of you every night. Darling, I'm never lonely. Whenever you are inside.
I have some coffee for me.
Okay, I'll put coffee in there.
Then please. The cream's for our cereal.
Oh, I thought it was for coffee. I put cream in coffee, too. I think that's enough.
Then we have some coffee.
Very good.
I've given you my heart.
I hate to think what I might have done with my life if he had not entered it. And the amazing thing about Gary was I knew that I was not attractive, and he apparently did not. Yeah. I'm sorry. That was a very basic issue in my life.
I love you. For sentimental reasons.
He hated to be told about people who are dying as passing. He said, they're not passing, they're dying. And if anybody came to see him the last few months, they say, well, how are you doing? I'm dying. Toward the end, though, he started to mellow a little bit on that. And I can tell you, he's there.
Stop. It was almost like, I don't know where that was coming from, but it came to both of us at the same time. After a couple of years of working to go to Alaska, we came to realize that was not what we were supposed to do with our lives. So we dumped it. Wow. Went back to Bolivia. But we didn't know it was Bolivia at that time.
We took the train to New York, and we were to take a ship down then to the coast of Chile. David had had his fifth birthday 2 weeks earlier. Mary Margaret was still three, almost four, and Gary Nathan was a year and a half. And we got on the Santa Maria, which was a Grace Line ship, which carried 52 passengers maximum and cargo. We were the only missionaries. The rest were a couple of Latin Americans who were going to Chile and several families who were working in the copper mines, American families. It took us 15 days. We went through the Panama Canal, and then it took us 15 days to get down to Arica. So I had the three children to take care of. So I put a body harness on Gary Nathan so he couldn't get away. I held the other end tightly. And Mary Margaret held my hand, and David had to be on his own. The ship has been anchored since early in the morning and is rolling gently from side to side as huge waves move in from across the Pacific. Just looking down at the water makes my stomach churn. Arica has no port, no wharf. Old rowboats with sides a few inches above the water level carry passengers from ships across hundreds of yards of open sea to a little dock on the beach. There's a little boat waiting for us. For a few moments, it lies in a trough between towering hills of water. They were just immense. Then the next, a few minutes later, you're at the top, wobbling at the top of this wave with huge chasms on either side of the boat. It was scary. I won't look down. The baby is safe in my arm. I'm not going to lose the purse, the camera, or the shirts, and surely Gary is watching out for the other two children. But I look back at the ship. Goodbye to milk, white tablecloths, and English. I look over to the coast of South America. Hello to a new language, a new life, whatever it may be. Properly attired, I am laughing as we swing. It was the year of intense inflation, so there was no bread. There was no meat. There was no flour to bake with. We couldn't afford canned goods, and there were no, of course, frozen goods in those days. There was nothing to eat. There were no dairy products. In the first 6 weeks, Gary lost 30 pounds, and I lost 15. How long do you eat oranges and bananas before you don't want to see another one and you're so hungry for meat? David got hepatitis that first year after we'd been there only about 6-7 months. And I had no idea that in the years to come we would live without water, sometimes for 2 weeks. We got bathed and clothes washed once a week on a normal basis. It was a different life. But oh, I felt so privileged being there. I loved every minute. And when people at home would say, oh, you're so noble to put up with this hardship, I'd think, oh no, I'm so lucky. You are doing the hard part, raising the money. I'm having all the fun. It was being immersed in the Bolivian life and culture. I wanted the children to feel Bolivian. And incidentally, there were more children. Katie came along.
I am Katie. My amiga is Hortensia, and I always play with her.
My dream baby, she had black hair and brown eyes, just like I've been ordering the other three to be, and they weren't. And she was a girl. I wanted another girl. Then, to my surprise, 2 years later, Heidi came along. Oh, good. Katie needs a good companion. Heidi was so sweet and little and dainty.
Who's my friend, is Karen and Gordita.
Who are you?
Heidi.
Oh, isn't that nice?
Yeah.
I named her Heidi Linnea, thinking of a Swiss flower, idolize. Then, surprise again, there was Christina, big, bouncing, blonde, very Swedish looking, so she got the name Christina. In addition to teaching all the years I was in La Paz, I also ran after-school clubs. I had campfire girls for the girls, because I thought the Girl Scouts in Bolivia were too militaristic and boring. And I had a Cub Scout group for Gary Nathan and his friends. And to this day, those campfire girls have never forgotten all the crazy things they experienced with me. They still want me to come to Bolivia, and we'll set up a tent in the backyard, and I'll get Marita to come, and we'll all spend the night in the backyard in a tent, just like we used to. I'm a little old for that now, I think. Anyway, it was a lot of fun, and they've never forgotten. Looking back on it, 6 children was probably more than we should have had. But on the other hand, I could have the 6, still teach, and run all my activities outside the home because of Teresa. She carried Heidi on her back for almost a year while Heidi recuperated from an illness. She was like a big sister to Margie. She was wonderful. One of the reasons we hardly ate in Bolivia was that I was squirreling away money. I had decided that before our oldest, David, left home for college, that we should go to Europe, make a definitive trip to Europe. So I skimped and saved, and sure enough, we took camping equipment and spent 3 months camping in Europe. But the wrong time of the year, it was pretty cold. But we had a wonderful time, and that in itself is a whole film. So,
let's take a trip in a trailer. No need to come back at all. Let's take a powder to Boston for chowder. Let's get away from it all. We'll travel round from town to town. We'll visit every state.
And I'll repeat, I love you, sweet.
In all the 48. Oh,
the Methodist Board of Missions asked Gary to move to Chile to take the directorship of Santiago College, a very elitist girls' school that had drifted away from the church. I had a very bad feeling about going, almost a feeling of doom, but we went. Gary was thrilled to be in charge of something so prestigious. It was the most expensive, most elitist school in the country. It was 3 years of misery because Right after we got there, there were the elections, and Salvador Allende was elected president, and he was a socialist. And the oligarchy who ran our school, who made up the board and controlled it, school, sensed immediately that Gary was not one of them, and it became apparent that his feelings were to the left, that he appreciated Allende. So the next 2.5 years, they just made life hell for us. Even the children got some of the brunt of it. Christina was told that her father, across the first grade table, or second grade table, your father's a communist. So we all felt it. Finally, they forced Gary out of the directorship and the family out of the country. This was a blessing, because if we had been there a few months later, fulfilling our last year of commitment, Gary would have been thrown in the stadium. He might have, and tortured, he might have even become one of the disappeared that were never seen again, because his co-worker in the church was thrown in the stadium and tortured. So Gary was, to them, a worse enemy than our friend was. So fortunately, we left Chile and came back to the United States. When we returned to the United States, we had no house, no car, no furniture, no money, no savings, no new clothes, and 3 kids and undergraduates in college. And somehow we struggled along. Gary got a job teaching in Southern Illinois at a college. He stayed there 3 years. Then he bounced from one job to another, having a lot of fun. As for me, I was asked to help the school district in Urbana to develop a program for immigrant children to learn English. So I developed one, got state funding, and then they asked me to please direct it. Well, I said I'd stay for 1 year to get it started and then join my husband in Southern Illinois. I stayed 20 years. During that time, a couple of years after we began the program, I developed a new approach for teaching English as a second language to children. And that approach is still the standard approach today.
English language in a content-based ESL program, then, is taught simultaneously with the content of the lesson.
The program that I developed with our staff became the standard ESL approach for children in the nation. During those years, also, I was fortunate to get a Fulbright grant to go to India for the summer. Unforgettable experience. I actually saw and talked with Indira Gandhi on her front lawn. Imagine. Since Gary was living sometimes in different places around Illinois, I kept an apartment in Urbana. And I had nothing to do in the evenings, and I don't like bridge that much, so I started taking classes. I loved to learn, and I wound up doing a PhD. It was more of a hobby than a professional goal, but it did open the doors later for me to teach at the U of I and in several colleges and universities in the Midwest. After retirement, I was hired by a Korean company to establish an English language franchise program in Korea. So I spent 2 years bouncing back and forth on 14-hour flights to Seoul. In 1990, Gary came up to Belleville for his aunt's funeral and called me long distance. He said, "Guess what? The Fritz family homestead is coming up for sale, I hear. Are we interested?" I said, "Yeah, let's get it." So we did. And as soon as I retired, we moved up in 1993. what I like to do is get out on bundle up and get out on the snowshoes after a snowfall like this. It's really cool to go tromping around.
Prosecution, agreeing to say that he committed the crime with the four original sailors. 13 years after the murder, he wanted us to know the truth.
The house is 150 years old. We've acquired more acres. We now have over 160 acres. I love this place. Gary loved it. He felt as if his ancestors were here present with him. And right over the hill, out the back, nowhere the hill, Gary and David are buried. I love this place. We've all had such wonderful experiences here, and I have cherished each moment with each one of you. I'll never forget them. As a child, I was swept away by Laura Ingalls Wilder's book, A Little House in the Big Woods, and I wanted to live on the frontier, facing all the challenges there were, maintaining your own life alone without help. And then that developed into a desire to be a dairy farmer when I was in junior high. Finally, in high school, it occurred to me that my adult life was ahead of me, and I could see three directions it might take. The first would be a typical housewife in a suburban area, nice little house, husband goes to work in the morning. Or maybe I would have a life of adventure where I'd travel and meet up all kinds of obstacles and challenges. It'd be exciting. Or even, what do you know? I'd read One of the Wind too often. I could see myself living on a plantation like Tara in a beautiful house. Now when I look back on my life, I think with marvel that all the things I wanted to have happen have come true, including those dreams of my childhood of living in a suburb in a nice little house with a husband that went to work, Urbana for 20 years. I had adventure, glorious adventures, in many places in the world. And finally, this may not be Tara, and I'm no Scarlett O'Hara, but I love the life in the country with the lovely, wonderful house and all those acres. And now, what are my dreams for the future? I want this wonderful place, this beautiful home, all the surrounding acres, to be a center for our whole family, a place that you love to come to, a place that I enjoy every minute that you're here, and that we will always be together as a family.